David Attenborough. The Early Years. Zoo Quest for a Dragon. Written and read by David Attenborough.
Most of the animals that appeared on British television screens in the 1950s did so sitting on doormats. Television was essentially a live medium. Film, being expensive, was seldom used except for the newsreel. And to appear on television, people and animals had to go to Alexandra Palace in North London. There, two small studios, the only ones in the country, produced each day the 4 to 5 hours of programmes that then constituted the total television provided for the public. Those responsible for the programmes, and those who watched them, believed that the most precious quality of the infant medium was its immediacy. The events appearing on their screens were actually happening as they watched them. That knowledge gave viewing a special tingle that has now largely vanished. If an actor forgot his lines, then the prompt was audible. If the politician lost his temper, then all saw him do so, and there was no chance of him having second thoughts and insisting that his incautious words were edited out. And if animals misbehaved, the embarrassment of their handlers was relished by everyone. One of the most popular programmes of the time was presented by George Cansdale, the superintendent of the London Zoo. Each week he transported some of the more reasonably sized and amenable of his charges from Regent's Park to Alexandra Palace and sat them on a doormat-covered table, blinking in the intense lights of the studio so that he could demonstrate their anatomy, their bravery, and their party tricks. Mr. Cansdale was an expert naturalist, wonderfully adept at handling animals and persuading them to do what he wanted. Even so, there were accidents, to the intense delight of those watching. His performers regularly relieved themselves on the doormat or, with luck, all over his trousers. Occasionally, they even escaped. A small African squirrel once leapt from the demonstration table onto the microphone boom that had come recklessly close to it, scampered across the studio and found refuge in the ventilation system. There it lived for weeks, making regular appearances in the dramas, variety shows and religious programmes that continued to come from its studio. Then, in 1953, a new kind of animal programme appeared. A Belgian explorer and filmmaker, Armand Dennis, together with his glamorous British-born wife, Michaela, came to London from Kenya to publicise a feature-length documentary that they had made for the cinema called Below the Sahara. Some of the unused footage they had shot in Africa during the making of the film they put together into a half-hour programme showing elephants, lions, giraffes and all the rest of the famous and spectacular big game of the East African plain. The programme was a huge success. Although the animals didn't have the titillating unpredictability of those produced by Mr. Cansdale, they were majestic and marvellous in their proper setting. Viewers responded with such enthusiasm to this new kind of animal programme that the television authorities immediately asked for more. Why not a whole series that could run week after week? The Dennises, who had been filming in Africa for years and had a vast library of animal footage, saw the possibilities and needed little persuasion. So the first On Safari series began. For me, a 26-year-old novice television producer with 2 years broadcasting experience and an unused zoology degree, anxious to make animal programmes myself, it seemed that each of these two formats had its own particular quality and limitation. I had already produced, besides ballets, party political broadcasts, short stories and archaeological quizzes, a series of 3 programmes narrated by one of the great scientific figures of the time, Sir Julian Huxley, in which he demonstrated the meaning and function of animal patterns and shapes. To illustrate his words, I had borrowed some of the animals from Mr. Cansdale's London Zoo, and in doing so I had met the zoo's curator of reptiles, Jack Lester. Although from his earliest years he had had a passion for animals, Jack had no formal zoological training, and his first job was in a bank. However, he swiftly moved to the bank's overseas branch and so managed to get to West Africa. There, he had indulged his enthusiasm for collecting and keeping reptiles, and he soon became widely acknowledged as an expert. After the Huxley series was over, we met to discuss what to do next. I thought I had an idea which might get him back to his beloved West Africa, and I with him. My plan was simple. The BBC and the London Zoo should mount a joint animal collecting expedition. I would direct film sequences showing Jack searching for and finally capturing a creature of particular interest. The sequence would end with a close-up of the animal in his hands. The picture would then dissolve into a similar shot of the same creature, but live in the studio, in the Cansdale manner. Jack would then demonstrate its particular characteristics, and if necessary, get bitten and soaked. Then viewers would be returned by way of film to Africa and another search and capture. The scheme seemed an excellent one. The only problem was that the zoo at the time had no intention of sending out a collecting expedition, nor had the BBC any ambition to embark on the highly specialised and presumably wildly expensive business of making natural history films. Jack and I decided that we might overcome both these obstacles with a single, properly stage-managed lunch, at which executives from both the zoo and the BBC would meet under the impression that the other already had such a plan in his mind. The lunch duly took place in the zoo restaurant. Jack and I were there to prompt and steer our seniors. Both executives left after coffee, each convinced that he had a lot to gain from joining in the other's plans, and to our incredulous delight the very next day, we were both separately told to go ahead. We agreed on the area to visit without any trouble. Jack's bank had been in Sierra Leone. He knew the country and he knew the fauna. He had a lot of friends there who could give us help. I was convinced, however, that if the television programmes were to be a success, the expedition would have to have a particular objective. A rare creature that preferably had never been seen alive in captivity. An animal so romantic, rare and exciting that the quest for it would sustain the viewer through at least half a dozen half-hour programmes. It was a difficult bill to fill. The only creature Jack could think of in Sierra Leone that could even remotely qualify was a bird called Picathartes gymnocephalus. It seemed to me that rousing the British public into a frenzy of excitement over the search for a creature with a name such as that would not be easy. Had it no other? Bald-headed rock crow, Jack said. That seemed hardly any better. However, there was no other contender, so Picathartes became our target. One further crucial issue had to be settled. We needed a cameraman. The BBC at the time worked exclusively on 35mm film, the gauge used for cinema films, in which industry all of its film cameramen had learned their skills. 16mm film was used only by amateurs and was referred to derisively by professionals as bootlace. On the other hand, the 35mm stock and camera were so heavy and bulky that even though I had never done such work, I doubted very much if we would be able to take them into the sort of situations I had in my mind's eye. Since no BBC staff cameraman at the time had any experience or inclination to work with bootlace, I had to look elsewhere. Soon I heard of Charles Lagus, a man of my own age who had just returned from an expedition to the Himalayas looking for the abominable snowman. There he had worked as assistant to Tom Stobart, the brilliant filmmaker who had been a member of the first successful expedition to Everest and had made a magnificent film of the climb. From him, Charles had learned a great deal about expedition filming and the use of 16mm film. Jack and I asked Charles to join us. He needed no more than a pint of beer to make up his mind to do so. Jack decided he would need help in looking after the animals as they were caught, and he recruited a sagacious and wily head keeper from the zoo's birdhouse, Alf Woods. So, in September 1954, the four of us set off for Sierra Leone. We spent 3 months there. We filmed pythons and chimpanzees, mantises and weaver birds. Jack assembled a collection of some 50 snakes and hundreds of birds, as well as mongooses, otters, giant rats and bush babies. We even found, filmed and captured Picathartes gymnocephalus. It turned out to be a bizarre crow-sized bird with a bald yellow head that built dramatic mud nests on the sides of huge rock boulders.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.